We're going to start in 8 minutes.
Get a little bit of gasoline. Welcome to another crime scene. Yeah. Get a little bit of gasoline.
I'ma make it burn. I'ma make it burn. I'ma make it burn. I'ma make it burn. I'ma make it burn.
Welcome to another crime scene. Yeah. Get a little bit of gasoline.
I'ma make it burn, 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 I'ma
put a little bit of shit, 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 put a little bit of shit.
got a little bit of gasoline. Welcome to another crime scene. Yeah. Got a little bit of gasoline.
What's up, everybody? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Nice, nice. Welcome to Everything Real Estate, episode one. Let me see if the guest is in here. Yeah.
You're on your maiden voyage. Congratulations, Justin.
One second. Let me turn this off. What'd you say, brother?
I said congratulations. It's your maiden voyage. This podcast. Right.
Man, I was on that other one, but I had to make my own, man, to get my own thing going, you know.
Yep.
Let's see. Let her know. Are y'all ready? Drop some fire emojis. Y'all ready for this? Let's see. Been a crazy day already, y'all. Let's see.
Yeah, I saw you going at 5 a.m.
Oh, bro. It's been crazy. Been setting up a lot of stuff. All right, here we go. I think I made her host. Are you host, Vina?
I'm trying to have my video, but it's not working.
It's not working. There you go. Kind of.
I hear. So I have an external video. I turned it off because it clearly did not work. Hi.
Hi. How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
Doing great. It's been a crazy morning already.
I've been recording podcasts. Thursday is like the day I record. And then the last one, I didn't realize it was live. And then he was like talking. And I was like, I have to go. I have another call. I got to get up.
But it was another one.
Yeah, that's what I was like. I got to go. I have someone else I have to go to. It's also live, so I can't be late.
Right. Want to introduce yourself?
Yes. Hi, guys. I'm Bina Jetty. I see some familiar faces in here. I'm Bina Jetty. I'm the founder of a company called Vibe Funds. I'm a large multifamily owner operator. We focus on Class B assets in the Sun Belt plus Arizona, which actually I had a meeting last night. So that might be changing what our markets are. So stay tuned for that. But we do value add assets primarily, and we typically operate on, about a 5-year hold period.
Awesome. So you're updating your buy box?
I am. We're always updating our buy box. So we're always looking at what the market's doing. And so I'll be updating that here soon.
So what's your goals for 2023?
That's a good question. I am still setting goals this year because I feel like every time I set a goal, it doesn't feel like it's quite right. And so I've been recalibrating and changing them like almost every 2 or 3 days this year so far. One obviously is going to be to finally cross the $1 billion mark, which will happen this year. But 2 is more around education and impact. I started my community last year, and then I started the vault at the end of last year in December. And now I'm very seriously considering whether or not I do a mastermind of some sort. So I know Victor is so happy. I heard him thinking as I'm talking. I'm really looking into what that would look like. What I want to do is I want to make sure if I take on something like that I can really deliver at 110%. That's really what. So my goal is to figure out what I can do to have the most impact in 2023 on new investors that want to get started. I also want to set the gold standard for how we talk about multifamily, how we look at multifamily, who is represented in multifamily. I want to come in and kind of change the way it's always been done.
Nice. You're going to change the game.
I hope so.
That'd be cool. So today you're going to talk about passive income, right?
And finding equity. Yes.
I love it.
Do you want to do it in Q&A format, or do you want me to?
We can do that whichever way. What do y'all think?
And we have like a lot of people on here. I know a lot of people here are Elizabeth, who is absolutely the best note taker on the face of the planet. And she's like so valuable to our community. She's amazing. She's in here. There's so many people in here. Do you guys want to do a Q&A on raising capital? Yeah.
We should do that.
All right. I love it. Let's do it. Okay. So I think you can raise your hand. Can you raise your hand? You would think I would know this by now, having done as many Zooms as I have, but I don't.
I'm going to ask everybody to unmute to see. Wait, no, they can unmute themselves, actually.
Yeah, I think they can just raise
it. Yeah, I can unmute it myself, so.
Hello.
This is Doc. How you doing, Vina?
I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing awesome.
I think you were just with Pace, weren't you? I think I saw a photo with you.
Yeah, that was me. That was my ugly mugshot.
Never.
Yeah, that was me. I got to see him last night. Poor guy, tired. He tired. And
he goes nonstop. He'll be here in Dallas next week, so I'll see him. Or wait, I guess in a few days. I can't keep my days straight.
Hey, likewise. I saw the Zoom pop up. I'm like, let me jump on it. It was spur of the moment. I'm never on Zooms like I should be. So, where I'm in the community. So I got to get back in.
I love it.
A little bit, so.
I love it. Well, welcome back to the community.
Thank you.
Okay, if we don't have questions, like I can talk about raising capital all day long, but I think you guys should probably just be asking me questions if you haven't raised capital. That's there we go.
I'll ask a question. Oh, let me raise my hand.
No, you're good.
Hi, Shane.
How you doing?
Hey, good to see you.
Good to see you. Thanks, Justin, for putting this together. I appreciate it.
No problem, brother.
Davina, it's a overall question. When you're raising capital for a project, for a specific purchase,
mm-hmm.
a syndication, are you raising through a fund? Are you bringing on partners? What's that overall format look like?
Okay, this is a really good question. Okay, so I think that there is a lot of misunderstanding about what a syndication is versus a fund or a JV partnership, because I get this question all the time. Do you recommend a syndication or a JV structure? And I'm like, well, that's like asking me, do I recommend strawberries or Mercedes? I like both. Like, I mean, actually, that's not even that true. I don't really love Mercedes, so I take that part back. But what I'm saying is you can like both, you can do both, you can structure as both. What a syndication is, it's simply putting together a group of people and putting their money together, right? And you're going to rely on some kind of exemption, whether it's Reg D or Reg A or, you know, Reg S or whatever the Reg CF, whatever the exemption you're going to be relying on is. But all syndication means is you're putting together, you're pooling together money.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that in the format of a JV. You can syndicate a fund. You could do a direct asset. All of these are not mutually exclusive terms. With that, we do have a JV. So we actually do all of these things. So we have a JV with our JV partner, who is our co-sponsor or co-GP. And so we operate our deals together and we operate jointly as one venture. Then we syndicate our deals, and we syndicate our deals in two ways. One way is through a fund. We actually are getting ready to close. Rev Fund One is closing. It's a $100 million value add fund that we put together. It's semi-blind. So what it does is it says like, hey, investor, we're going to go out and buy 5 to 7 assets that fit these criteria and put them into the fund. Do you want to invest in that? Still syndicated funds. The second way we do it, and this is probably a little bit more common, is we go through a direct deal syndication or a direct asset syndication. So what that means is I have property 123 Main Street Apartments. Yep. This is what it is. This is the business plan. This is what we like about it, what we don't like about it, the submarket, everything about it, right? And then we say, do you want to invest in that? And then we syndicate that as well through that entity. Does that make sense why a syndication is different than syndication is a very generic catch-all term?
Yeah, syndication is more just the accumulation of fund.
Correct. Exactly.
Yeah. Got it.
And so did anybody, is everybody like clear on that? I just want to make sure, because I know this is a question that comes up a lot. Does it make sense what a syndication is versus, like, I want everybody in the room to understand this. Yes?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, good, good, good.
So then
the volume didn't go away. Tammy asked if the volume went away. No, the volume's still here, I think.
Hello.
Mic check 1, 2.
I know. I got this fancy mic, so I want people to like notice it, and I want people to say nice things about my microphone. Okay.
That is a nice microphone. Kind of
like thank you. Wow. I'm so glad there were so many unsolicited compliments about my microphone.
But what about other structures, Vina, like Reg A type structures and crowdfunding type scenarios? Yeah. What are your thoughts on those?
Yeah. So what we're talking about is we're still talking about a syndicated structure. What we're talking about specifically is what exemption are we relying on to sell this security without having to register it? So you can still syndicate in a Reg CF or a Reg A or a Reg D, 506B, 506C. They're all different structures that work. There's no reason you can't do a Reg CF. I think there's a purpose for each of these, depending on what your asset is and what you're trying to do. There's a purpose and time to use each of those.
Right. Okay.
Does that make sense?
Indeed. Yeah, it does. I'm just curious because I like Reg A because you have the ability to, you know, you can essentially advertise to certain audiences and stuff as well, right? So, you know, allow you to reach a wider investor audience with, you know, maybe less dollars, let's say, with the intent. But then there's the next step of that because now it's actually a registered security, right? So you could actually potentially go ahead and IPO that and draw money from a public market as well.
Yeah, so a Reg A is probably as close as you get to a public company with it still being a private offering, right? Here's the challenge that, let me just first take, like, how many people in this room know what all of these, like Reg A, Reg CF, Reg D, if you know what they are, can you put a one in the comments? And if you don't, put two. Okay, we have a lot of people that don't know what these are yet. So I want to, if it's okay, I'd like to take a step back and just talk about what
they are generally. Yeah.
And then I want to also
let's get everybody leveled. I know what they are, so, you know.
Yeah, let me just level set real quick, and then I'll talk to you specifically about why a Reg A probably doesn't make sense. Now, I have to start this conversation off by saying I'm not an attorney, and I have, like, no licenses, so you shouldn't even listen to anything I have to say here. So that's, like, the disclaimer out of the way, right? Okay, so you have four common exemptions that you're going to raise under. You're going to raise under a Reg A, which is it's a public offering in the sense that you can advertise. Now, keep in mind, there are very specific nuances to each of these raises, but here's the, and you can take money from unaccredited investors, and they don't have to be sophisticated. There are limitations on how much money you can take from each investor. I think it's like, there's two tiers of Reg A. There's a 25 million and 75 million. We don't do Reg A, so I'm not as versed in it.
Yeah, there are two tiers. Yeah.
There's two different tiers, and you can only take in a certain amount of money where you're limited to, it's like 10% of the net worth or 10% of the income. I think it's the greater of the two. And then it's, or X amount of dollars. And I have a,
there's an additional requirement for accredited investors now, as well as education. You can get a license now or be involved with a fund, and they'll consider that accredited as well.
Right.
They just added that rule.
Yes, but that's relevant for Reg D, which I'll tap in on that in a minute, because we're talking about just Reg A right now. So the drawbacks of a Reg A, and this is actually why I think a Reg A probably doesn't work for most people. One, it's very expensive to register. It can cost you anywhere from $150,000 to maybe $200,000 to properly register Reg A. Secondly, you have to use a FINRA approved platform, which is also true of a Reg CF. So that's, like, you know, it's a hurdle. It's an administrative hurdle, not the hardest one to overcome, but it's still an administrative hurdle, especially if you're starting out. And third, it takes a long time to get established. So you likely are going to be establishing a Reg A without a single asset in mind, but really, like, on a semi-blind fund basis. And that's a great way to go out and raise capital. But without a track record or history, if you're just starting out, it can be really tough to raise capital that way. So that's a Reg A. And that's why I think most people, Reg A's, when you really look at the nuts and bolts of it, it won't work for most real estate deals, especially if you're starting out. Your Reg CF, your regulation, I keep wanting to call it cash flow, but it's not, it's crowdfund. Okay, that is a little bit, it's like almost like a mini version of the Reg A raise. And what that does is it allows you to raise up to $5 million as an issuer in a calendar year. And what you can do with that is you can raise from both accredited and unaccredited, and you can advertise or solicit in the public domain. Again, the challenge of that is it takes a really long time to set up, and there's a significant administrative hurdle. For someone like me, the biggest challenge is I'm limited to $5 million. And if I want to buy a $100 million asset, I need more than $5 million. So it's just not enough for me. But if you're doing a deal where, if your general deal size is like $5 to $10 million of total, like gross asset value, GAV, gross asset value, then Reg CF might be a really good option for you, because you can now take investors that are not necessarily accredited into your fund. So that's a Reg CF. Then we have Reg D, which is the most common exemption that most companies rely on. Within Reg D, there are two different subcategories. They're called rules. I don't know. And I don't know who lettered all of these because there's absolutely no system to this, obviously. So on a Reg D, like David, you have rule 506, B like boy, or C like Charlie. 506B says that you can raise an unlimited amount of funds and you can have up to 35 unaccredited but sophisticated investors, and everybody else has to be an accredited investor. Now, what's important about this is you cannot solicit from anybody that you do not have a pre-existing substantive relationship with. So if I have a deal on the table right now and I want to raise money on it, I can't come even into this room and say, hey guys, I have this deal. It's a really great deal. Here are the returns. If you want to invest, let me know. And then have you invest in that deal, because I don't have a relationship with everybody in this room. So I can't publicly advertise this. Right. But if I'm in a room with five people I know really well, then yes, I can talk about it. Now a 506C, so Reg D 506C, on the other hand, allows me to come into this room and say, hey guys, I have this deal. It's called Stonebrook. It's in North Carolina. It's 192 units. It's an amazing deal. Here are the projected returns. Do you guys want to invest? You know, let me know. Contact me. Let me know if you want to invest in it. But because it's on a 506C raise, I can only have accredited investors. So that means I can't have even one unaccredited investor in my deal. Now, as for what an accredited investor is, there's two primary ways that most investors are going to meet accreditation status. The first way is going to be that they make either, okay, actually, I feel like I should, there's so many people in here that did my legal challenge. Is there anybody in here that is willing to come off mic and tell me the two major ways? This is like a test. I'm sorry, Justin, I've hijacked this Zoom to like test everybody. Cause like, I know Victor has to know by now. Max should know. Nobody's going to tell me what it is. You guys have not learned this yet. I'm so disappointed right now. Victor, what are the two ways? Tell me.
Come on, Victor.
Come on. You got to show up.
It's like $200,000 for a season per year, $300,000 for a married couple.
Yes, yes. And then what's the other
$100,000 net worth as a single or as
a million.
I love it. Yes, $1 million net worth. So it's $200,000 or more if you are single for the last 2 years in income with a reasonable expectation of maintaining that in the future. $300,000 or more if you're married for the last 2 years with a reasonable expectation of maintaining it. If you don't meet it through income requirements, you can meet it through your net worth, which is $1 million or more of net worth, excluding your primary home. So the equity in your primary home does not count. It's either or. You don't have to meet both of these. You can meet one or the other. Now, there are some other ways, like Michael said earlier, you can take some certain tests. So if you are considered an investment professional, I think the Series 65, 63, yeah, 7 all qualify you for this.
The easiest to be in 65, right? So
I don't know which is easiest because I haven't done any of them. So they all sound equally distasteful for me, but yes,
they're pretty distasteful. Yes.
Yeah. So, and I'm a finance major and I still am like, no thanks. But you can do any one of those, which will give you accreditation status, or if you're a knowledgeable employee, director or officer of a fund, you can also be considered as accredited as well.
That was recently added in the past year, by the way. So a lot of people do not know about that.
Yeah, that was added last year.
Yeah.
And so these are important for you guys to know because you need to know who your investor base is, right? Like if you have all unaccredited investors in your database, you probably don't want to raise on a Reg D 506C because you won't really have any investors. But if you have all accredited investors, that might be a great option for you. The 506B is the most commonly used exemption for private placements across the country. But we've moved from 506C to, or 506B to 506C. That's what we do now. But you want to be careful that you're reaching out to your securities attorney ahead of time because you may or may not be violating the exemption that you can rely on if you don't do that. So does that make sense, Michael, about why I think a Reg A probably doesn't work for the vast majority? Have you raised capital before?
Yes, I have.
Okay. What exemption did you use?
It was mostly just for syndication, not for 506 C. So
okay. It was a 506 C?
Yeah, but I've been looking at doing Reg A.
Okay, so if you've raised on a 506 C before, what asset class are you raising on? Are you raising on multifamily?
No, this was general businesses.
General, so, are you
buy and sell business? So.
Okay, are you going to still raise for that, or are you going to raise for real estate?
No, I'm not doing. I don't want to do that anymore. I'm going to do business privately. I don't need that vehicle. I want to do real estate, so I'd rather. I'm looking at a Reg A. Consider 506 C. One thing, there's some things that interest me about the Reg A, kind of in the nuts and bolts of it, and being able to have that public securities that I can then put on the DTC, and you know, that gives us a lot of advantages to raising capital in a more nimble way. But you're correct, the investment up front on it is the problem. And so that's where everybody hits a skid mark. It's like, oh wait, I gotta, you know, set this up ahead of time. Mm-hmm. and it's like, you know, and it can cost $200,000, about, you know, that's about $150,000 in legal fees. Mm-hmm. It can be done cheaper if you know what you're doing, and you have friendly securities attorneys, which I do. So it's about a $50,000 for me. It's about a $50,000 overhead. So that's kind of something I've been looking at doing. So that's why I wanted your thoughts on it. Just to, you know, you're really the expert multifamily in it. I think it would be a good vehicle if somebody go down that path. I've also talked to some investors that are going down that path. I don't know. I know they run in like the Pennington circles and stuff like that. And some of those guys have been doing Reg A's. In fact, I met one guy that's his company does is it just sets up Reg A's. So, but he's pretty expensive as well.
Yeah, these are not cheap and they're not designed to be cheap, right? Because you're raising other people's, you're using other people's money. So I want to just be really clear on something for everybody that's here and listening. If you are raising capital from anybody that is not yourself, you want to be reaching out to a securities attorney, because I see this all the time where someone will be like, oh, but you know, I'm just putting together a group of people to buy a single family home. And it's like my friends and neighbors and family. Okay. But you are selling a security, so you need a securities attorney to bless this, right? Like whether or not you use an exemption or how you structure or whatever, there's so many ways to do that. And I'm not an attorney, so I can't tell you guys what the right way to do it is, but you definitely, anytime you're raising capital, you definitely want a securities attorney advising you on it. From a practical standpoint, I still—
Even the bandit signs that solicit investors for real estate are illegal. A lot of people used to see those a lot on the street corners.
What do you mean illegal?
They're soliciting security.
But it depends on what exemption. It just depends on what exemption it is, right? Because like I can do that. I can take out a billboard in Manhattan if I want, because I use a 506C.
Right.
So it depends.
A lot of these people don't use 506Cs for those exemptions. They're just a small shop trying to get investors to help them buy real estate assets. And those were illegal signs, because I know one of the companies that did it locally in my area. And I tried to tell them that it was illegal. I don't think they ever got caught, and SEC didn't say anything. But I've seen some stuff go pretty shady. I've seen ads on Facebook that probably shouldn't have been put out there. So,
yeah, I mean, it's hard to know without knowing what exemption someone's relying on or what they're doing. But generally speaking, before you go out to solicit any investors, you should talk to your securities attorneys. And, you know, guys, like this is not where you want to get caught up necessarily.
Yeah. And you also don't want to be priming either. So some people will talk about, oh, I'm going to do this. And, you know, and it's kind of prep people. And you can't do that either. You got to keep everything quiet until you can officially get everything registered, done. And then you can start soliciting those investors. So I've seen people do priming too.
I mean, Again, I think there's like a lot of fine lines here that we're talking about that aren't necessarily accurate for all of the exemptions that you can land.
They're not.
It's not illegal to sell a security. It is legal to sell a security. The question is do you have to register it or not register it, right? And you have to register it unless you have an exemption you can rely on. So if you can rely on an A or a Reg D or a Reg CF, then that's fine. That, and the reason why we look for exemptions to rely on is because the amount of administrative hurdle and practical hurdle that exists in registering is really high. And we want to make sure that if we have the ability to take an exempt position, we would do that. So that's what makes it important. And I know that Vernon and Victor both have their hands up. So I want to make sure we get to their questions too, but hopefully that answered your question.
I think so. I just kind of, like I said, I just wanted your general view on what you're doing. And I think I understand thoroughly.
Yes. So. Awesome.
It's better to listen to experts, right, than your own ideas, you know.
Of course.
I don't mind.
We all do that.
I don't mind being an innovator. I think I can be, and I am. But at the same time, you know, I got to weigh that with, okay, she's very successful.
Well, I appreciate that. And I appreciate you asking this question. I think it probably helped a lot of people learn about something new.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Hello, hello.
Hey, Vina. So I'll bring it back to raising capital.
Yes.
So where we started. So I had a deal come up and it was three beach houses for $6 million, right? Nice houses. The houses appraised for over the $6 million.
Okay.
But as far as getting money, I couldn't find non-recourse that would... that would give me an actual loan for that property. Everybody wanted to do recourse loans. But the problem that we was running into was that all the money is they used for Airbnb. So these three huge beach houses in a popular area, nobody would finance them or give complete financing because it was non-verifiable funds that would. So the funds were documented on an Excel sheet, but they couldn't be verified through the bank account. They wouldn't accept the Excel sheets.
Yeah, I do not know the answer to this question because I don't deal in the single family space really enough to know. But I don't think it's uncommon to require a guarantee on single family homes. But that's going to be a question better suited for somebody that is not me. I wish I could answer. I just don't know the answer and I don't want to steer.
Hey, no worries at all. I mean, that's kind of out of my realm also, but it came up and it was a good deal.
Yes.
So I tried to get it.
I love it. I mean, I think you were with Pace and he's probably the right person to have asked that question to.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's all good. I could get back to it if I need to. But that's all. I was just trying to bring it back to capital, and that was one thing I could think of. So
yeah, no, absolutely. The next person. Justin, I hate to do this, but I have a call I'm expecting in any minute now, and I'm going to have to jump off. But I can answer Victor and Elizabeth's question afterward, if not.
Hey, I'll cut off so everybody gets some time. So. That's it for me. I appreciate it, Vina.
Of course. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Oh, guys, this is my call. I'm so sorry, Justin. I've got to run. If you guys are going to be on here, I'll try to come back after this call. Thank you so much for having me, Justin. I appreciate you.
Thank you, Vina.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, one thing, you know, going back to what Vina was saying before, right? You know, a lot of us are looking to do so many different things from, especially going from single family to one of the things you really want to do is a mentorship. If you haven't yet, I would highly suggest go to Mastering Multifamily with Vina Jetty on Facebook, because she has dropped so much knowledge. You can tell people, you can even ask Elizabeth, she's doing a note taking, also Max. It's like, there's so many, she has given us so much information that, you know, I've been doing this for over 3 years right now, just learning. And then what happened along the way, you get nuggets from here, right? And there's so much gap in between each nugget. And what Vina actually did, she connected all the dots along the way for every Zoom that we've done. And if you want to be raising capital, one of the main things you want to do is continuous education. You know, there's always, everything is changing every day. There's new things that's going to go. You're not going to be able to keep up with it. So why not just find a person like an SEC lawyer? Nick, the lawyer, is one of the best ones that I've seen so far, who's willing to give up a lot of information. And then on top of that, you're able to have that relationship. You know, Vina's one of the people, the only person who really connected from the beginning process, the middle, and the end. You know, I'm a big Grant Cardone fan. I'm a 10Xer. I'm going to GrowthCon on Sunday. He's only doing specific niches. He's going to talk about underwriting and a little bit of value add. What Vina's done so far, you can even ask anybody in the group. She's telling you how at the very beginning, who's your team? And if you really want to get into this sector of multifamily, there's three things. Acquisitions, capital stack, and operations. Figure out which two are you the best ones and get into that. Everybody needs to learn how to raise capital. And by raising capital, meaning you need to know the laws, you need to know the rules, you need to know the strategies, you need to know if you have your processes in place. Do you have a CRM? How do you go and connect with them? Understanding who they are, verify if they're accredited, they're non-accredited. Put them in little buckets along the way. Do a newsletter. Talk about what's going on with the market. The market is crazy, right, guys? You have to keep up with that. And then put in the newsletter, say, hey, guys, this is what's going on. We're looking to do some business in Texas, Florida, North, South Carolina. We're looking at Atlanta, Georgia, parts of Tennessee. That's my buy box. And then what you do, you just send that information to all of your CRM and just keep track with everybody, and they can see what you're knowing. If they don't know you, they can't flow you, right? That's what Uncle G says, because it's all about information. You're giving them what you know and what you're working on so that when you're ready, hey, Justin, guess what? I got something for you. Let's talk and let's have a conversation. And this is what it's going to say. Let's go. Once you build those relationships, like Vina says, you have to do it. You know, I have five mentors, and it's growing every year. Why? Why do I do that? Why do I spend that money? It's because I'm spending that. The best investment anybody in this room is going to do is invest in yourself. It's not a waste of money. Don't worry about how much it is. Worry about the information, because that information is going to be $1 million piece of advice. It doesn't matter if it's $50,000, $25,000, $10,000. It doesn't matter, because you're going to be utilizing that as much as you can. I'm sorry, Justin. I just went on a whole rampage and everything else, but, you know, Vina's not here,
No, you can keep going, brother. But everybody needs to realize, too, back in the day, I used to say knowledge is power. Now I say applied knowledge is power, because you can't just take the knowledge and not do nothing with it. You have to apply it.
You know, even Elizabeth, if you want to unmute, you know, she has done some amazing things. We're talking. We've met. She came to my meetup in Dallas twice, back-to-back weeks. You know, that's massive action.
Yeah, and I'm coming to the one on the 16th too. I don't think it's your meetup that you're putting together. It's in Dallas, but I'll be at that one too. So hope I see you there.
No, I'll be in Vegas. I'll be in a GrowthCon.
Okay. Oh, I see. Okay, so it's around the same time. But I'm sure I'll see you in Vegas in April. So, and probably before then too. But yeah, like one thing I wanted to say to, like Victor was talking about marketing to your investors. I'm sure like a lot of people in here are either wholesalers now or they were in the past. You can think of your investors the way you market to your end buyers as a wholesaler. You know, you want to keep up with them, you want to talk to them, and you want to get their buy box. So for as an investor, you want to see what their returns are, what they're looking for, how conservative or aggressive are they? And that's essentially their buy box. So when you do get a deal or an offering, you can say, okay, this aligns with Victor's risk tolerance. So it's kind of similar. Like I know multifamily and single family can be very different, but when it comes to marketing and staying in front of your investors, it can be very similar to your end buyers. So,
well, you know, Elizabeth made a great point. You got to know your investors, right? Do they want to do it for tax benefits? Do they just want to park it and let it just sit there and collect? Or are they looking for another medium for just passive income? You know, there's so much stuff in there that you have to go, you can't just have one pitch. And before you pitch, you need to find their story out. Don't start pitching, talk to them. You got to build, they have to like you. They got to trust you. Then they give you your money to, they give you their money to you. So there's three steps you have to go and do before you start pitching. If you're going straight to the pitch, guess what? It's a zero. A confused mind will always say no. Because if it doesn't align to their purpose, it just goes in one ear out the other. That's true. If you start building that rapport with that person, like with me and Elizabeth, when we first met, we started talking. I didn't realize who she was until we started having it was just me doing my thing. I asked her what she's doing, where she's at, what's her market, and then we just build this great relationship. We're Elizabeth and Jared, we're talking now. She's in Houston, I'm in Dallas. Guess what? That's two of the best markets in Texas right now. So why would I not collaborate with her? She can take care of Houston. I'll take care of Dallas. I got Vino up here right up the road. It's a win-win-win. You know, you got Doc with her, Corpus Christi. You know, what? Why not work with him? It's like, I've known him for what? Almost a year. You know, you got Wes over here in Lubbock. Justin, where you at now? I know you're moving back and forth.
Livingston.
It's like, you know, there's so many markets here. Everybody here right now should be connecting with everybody in this room. No ifs, ands, or buts. You know, put your contact information, put it on your, you know, Elizabeth has her phone number on there. You got to put, you know, mine says Victor the Connector is my phone number. You have to do that everywhere you go. Danny does the same thing, you know.
Work because I would always hear like, oh, put your number on your Zoom name. And I'm like, okay, I'll do it. I don't think it's going to do anything. I get texts like a few times a week from people saying like, oh, I saw you on Zoom. Like, this is what I'm doing. Like, how can we work together? And I'm like, how did they get my number? And I'm like, oh, wait, it's in my Zoom name. So it actually does do something. It's beneficial because that person that reaches out to you, maybe you see like, chances are that not everybody is going to be somebody that you work with, but there may be somebody where you guys have the same goals and you can bring different skill sets to each other. So,
absolutely. Look, you know, Shane Roche right now, he's on this Zoom right now. If you're looking for some money and everything else, he's the guy to talk to because he's already doing funds. He's already doing raising and everything else. If you're a single family, that's a place to go. If you're looking for private money, he's the guy. If you haven't met Shane, man, you need to know that. And so, and there's so many people here in this room, Justin, that, you know, you brought together, you know, there's Peter right there. Peter from the Freedom Chasers, man. If you want to know some information, you need to follow these guys right here. They drop so much knowledge. It's so powerful. Your Peter's here. Get to know him. See what he does. He gives that group gives so much knowledge. Peter, I don't know how y'all do it. I don't know how y'all met, but when I met some of y'all guys up there at the Real Estate Summit with Grant, dude, y'all are killing it. So
yeah, Peter's absolutely amazing. I attended his broker outreach call and I was like, why was I not doing this sooner? So I can attest to that.
And guys, if you have questions, you know, let's talk. You know, I don't want to jump and take over your Zoom, Justin, or anything like
man,
that. But
let's network, man. Everybody networking. I do know Peter though. Me and him did some broker calls back in the day together.
But this is
me, Joey, and Peter. Was it Joey, right? Joey and Peter.
Yes, sir. Yep.
And then
there's a reason I do that broker call, Justin.
That's awesome.
Bro, you're killing it. I see you, bro. You're killing it, man.
That's why it happened, because of your call. And I just saw a massive need. People had such resistance to pick up the phone and do it. And that's what prompted the whole thing. And here we are 3 months later, we're still doing it.
Right. It's like a snowball effect. Now everybody's doing it.
Yeah.
But you have to have all those people around you. Why not take the opportunity that Justin just created for everybody and take full advantage of it, man? It's like, you know, Max is a great guy to know. You know, everybody here. It's like, just keep on doing it. It's massive action, guys. And don't be afraid. And if you're looking for a group to talk to, just, you know, say, hey, Justin, hey, let's talk about this. Let, you know, he's already has a platform. Help him. Anything you need, Justin, you let me know, man. Let's just go ahead and get help you build this freaking thing and blow it up. Because it's about giving to the community. No matter what you do, it's about give.
For sure.
Man. Put your platform in here so I can hit you up. Make sure you get some love on that platform.
I love it. Hey, I need a rental in Corpus Christi, too. I heard you're the guy, man.
Hit me up. Come to the office. Hey, I got you covered.
Send me a text, man. Let's work.
You got it, man. I got you. Well, I got your info already, so I'll reach out to you, my brother. See what we can do.
Right.
Well, are you coming down?
I go around Houston a lot. Right now I'm just hanging out in Livingston, just getting some stuff together with the music stuff, and then that's pretty much it, man. Just running around like a chicken with his head cut off, man.
Nothing wrong with that. I do the same thing. As long as you're making money while you do it, that's all that matters.
Right, right.
But yeah, I don't want to distract from the. What's that?
What's your markets, brother?
Oh, North Carolina, South Carolina, Atlanta, Florida, and Texas. So nice. That's my buy box. Yeah.
Everybody drop their buy boxes in the chat. So everybody knows what market you want to be in.
Hey, does anybody know? I was trying to do a quick flip the other day, a couple of days ago in Georgia. And the house was a small little cheap house that was being renovated. Georgia requires a wet signature to do it. They require somebody to be in person. But here's the thing. During COVID, they passed a law that you could do it electronically, and it just went out. It just faded where nobody is really using it anymore in December. But the caveat to what I'm saying is it's kind of optional if you want to do it, do a digital signature. Is anybody else running into that wet signature problem in Georgia where they want you to be there in person to close a deal?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I ran into that problem. I thought I mean, this was a quick $38,000 flip. And she was an older agent. So maybe a good nugget here is pick the younger agents. You get the older agents, they're stuck in their ways. But yeah, she wanted to do a wet signature and she wanted me to come up there. I'm like, I'm not coming up there. I'm like, we're going to DocuSign that bad boy. And I'm like, we'll do a mobile notary and a power attorney. I'm like, that's how we're going to do it. And she was like, no, I've been doing it for 30 years. And this is how we've been doing it. So figure I'd throw that out there and ask anybody if they ran into any problems like that.
That'd be a question next week for Abraham Gray. Next week.
Yeah. I thought about hitting them up, but when she started talking about wet signatures, I mean, for a quick $38,000 flip, I don't know if he'll run down there for that, you know, drive, you know, halfway across Atlanta. Just, I mean, potential $38,000 flip. I mean, it, you know.
Well, but, you know, also, Doc, is that you can also get a proxy to sign for you.
Yeah, the power attorney. But yeah. She didn't want to do it. She wanted a wet signature. She wanted somebody in person. That's the first time I ever ran into that in Atlanta. And I know a lot of people, you know, do deals out of Atlanta. So that's why I figured I'd ask.
I mean, if you need help in Atlanta, I got you. I'm boots on the ground if you need. I've never framed that situation myself, but if you need me to run somewhere, I can definitely help you out.
Okay. All right. Well, maybe. Okay. I'll hit you up after this call.
Okay.
After this Zoom. Quick is an easy, quick flip. I guess, Victor, that's where it's at. Just like you say, all you got to do is open your mouth. And you never know, right? Open your mouth. You never know what might come back at you.
That's how you and I met, brother.
I know, right?
Like the law of attraction. The law of attraction.
That's right. And if anybody is having any issues getting capital also, I know there's a lot of folks out here who do that. But if you need help with that, I could help you, you know, find you some capital. As long as the numbers match up, you know, where it's pretty decent, we can get you, you know, with some type of lender. Just keep in mind, you know, the numbers are kind of high. So just like Pay says, you want to be, and this is just my opinion, y'all, just as creative as possible. So you're not putting yourself in a position where you're going to be, you know, absorbing those high interest rates just to do a deal. So.
They're way high. Where are they at right now?
What do you mean? Where, who?
The at? Interest rates.
Well, I mean, there's low. I've seen as low as 6 and it's going up to 7. So I think it's going to go up a little bit higher than that. You know, my thought is it's probably going to be sitting at 8 to 9 being average. So, I mean, nobody wants to do that. I mean, I know I don't. You know, heck, we was talking about a deal last night, a potential deal. And it was a woman, it was a $600,000 house out here in Texas. And she recently got divorced, she refinanced it. So the house is in her name. She owes roughly about $240,000 on this house, but she wants to move out because it's too big. So her interest rate is 3%. So it's a perfect sub two deal to jump in there. If you can make those numbers work. So I was talking to the guy and it ended up being a good, get her $30,000 so she can move into her new spot. And then you keep $30,000, you know, of the deal if you can get somebody. And most of the time, and hopefully I don't offend nobody, but you know, it's a $600,000 house. The person you probably want to attract to that, especially in that type of situation is, you know, people who like to pretend like they got all, you know, they got a whole lot. You know, the pretenders, they want to pretend like they got all of this, or they made good money, they in 6 figures, but they broke. You know, you kind of want to attract people like that because they can't get a loan. So they'll take over that 3% versus, you know, somebody coming in and do 9%. So she got to get talked into a creative deal. And that was here in Texas, so.
It's also good to partner up with some mortgage brokers and then get the ones that disqualify for the loans, get them to send them over to you.
Well, I got a few that actually work in my office. One comes in on Tuesday and the other one comes in on Thursday to close deals. So I actually got that worked out. They're pretty good. They could get just about anybody. Well, not anybody, but they could get most people financed if they're trying to buy a house.
Love it.
Yeah. So, I mean, plenty of opportunity. Y'all hit me up. It's a lot going on down here in Corpus Christi. I'm trying to blow it up. So anywhere in Texas, up Texas, if y'all trying to get some news, you need something, some info, hit me up. More likely, I got the answer. I can find somebody who does have it.
So Airbnbs, they don't work out there right now, right?
No, they do. They absolutely work out here. But it's just you got to get the perfect deal, man, for it to work. I mean, the perfect deal. to get somebody out that house, because otherwise everybody want, they think that house is worth too much, or the house down the street didn't sell for enough, you know? So they want, hey, let's say they want $400,000 for that house. Yeah, it might be worth it. Yeah, you got a pretty pool, but if no property sold on your street, I'm not paying you $400,000 for that house, you know, because it may not necessarily be worth that. We all know it was a price hike last year where all the house values went up. So yeah, you know, what happens next year if they drop back down, you know? So yeah, so that's just my thought. But I ran off on a tangent, man. I forgot the question.
Bro, you're good. We were talking about Airbnb. You just went off.
Oh, okay. Yeah. The Airbnb is good here, man. But like in North Carolina, where I was looking at, yeah, man, they chopping down on Airbnbs, but not, it's still open right now. I mean, you, long as you can transition into a long term, it shouldn't be a problem, you know. So long as you're ready when they throw the hammer down to go long term, you should be all right. But yeah, it was an old deal that came back, and then they added some houses to it. They like, well, I want to be out the game, so here's my three houses, you can have them, and I'll give them to you, you know, for $6 million, which is roughly about 1.5 below what they're worth in the market. So it's good, but I know one of the properties need to be deeded. They said the property it was a deeding issue or something like that. And she don't want to do anything creative. She wants cash in hand, right? So, you know, she don't want to do any creative, but it's a beautiful deal, but nobody wants to do it, you know, without a guarantee. And right. I'm not going to put a guarantee on those houses, because what if the Airbnb don't work? You know what I mean? What if what she was making, I can't replicate that, you know? True. So, and yeah, so no, I don't want to put my name on it. I want to make sure we can do what was advertised.
Right. So you said you have private money guys, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have somebody?
I mean, I don't have them personally. They just, you know, I got a direct connection, and he got his own website where you can go and make requests and or you know, you tell me or we call them directly, and you know, you throw your deal up and be like, so since we're not realtors, you know, we can't, you know, we're not realtors, mm-hmm. So you gotta give it to him. He can't do it for you, but he'll tell you, hey, this guy will go ahead and finance you with this deal, so call this guy, make sure you tell him this info, and you know, you should be able to get this either recourse or non-recourse, you know what I mean? Nice. Now a lot of what they're doing is recourse, but they are doing some non-recourse. So if you got a deal that pencils out and it's a nice spread in there, you know, mm-hmm. they might go non-recourse on that puppy. So
I'm trying to get something for a 63 single family portfolio in Ohio. It cash flows $60,000 a month.
So you're trying to get it? You're trying to get a lender for it?
Yep.
I mean, the amount of money doesn't matter. It's just show me what the numbers look like. We could. I don't see why we couldn't get it done. He works in every state, so as long as the numbers are right. Do you want to do a non-recourse, or are you more into a recourse?
Probably non-recourse, right?
Yeah. Is it making money? Is it flowing and is verifiable?
Yeah, it's verifiable.
At least 2 years? Flows.
Huh?
It verifies for at least 2 years?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't see no problem with it. Yeah, let's talk, man. I'll hook you up with them, and see if you know, if he can get you the right person that'll actually fund the deal.
Right.
I mean, you know the interest rates, man. I mean, so you just long as you know the interest rates, they might, you know, they take a bite out your ass.
Right. So.
But yeah,
the cash flow is pretty good though, man. You know, it's pretty good. Yeah, it's good, man.
What is it? What is the cash flow on, you know, monthly?
60,000.
Oh shit. Okay. Yeah, that was 64 unit. Okay. And any rehab needed? Is it a value add?
Turnkey and it's all occupied.
Justin, how many units is it?
No, this is all single family. It's separate single family portfolio.
A single family portfolio. Gotcha.
Oh, I thought you said multi-family. Mm-hmm. Single family. Okay, so it's a portfolio. Okay. Well, you know those. I love those and I hate them. I love them because, you know, when you look at them and they're good, but the due diligence part of it is a pain in the ass.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah, all the lenders are going to want to see appraisals on all 64 units. And so there's a lot of investment on the front end. Those are, I mean, it's definitely doable. I can potentially help you with it, but it's a pain in the neck.
Man, I just want to close this already.
it's a purchase.
Mm-hmm. It's a purchase.
Yeah. Well, reach out to me. I'll see what I can do to help you.
Cool. Sounds good, man. I'm
loving this.
Look at us just networking in here.
This is beautiful, man. This is on point. So who else got some deals? Let's do some deals. Well, hey, I got 5 minutes. Who want to do some deals? Who got an open deal they need some help on? Or they want to, you know, get a teammate or some teammates?
It's funny you say that. I've got a private money deal that the challenge with it is it's in second position, but it's incredible leverage, right, with a super experienced borrower. So if somebody's got 300 grand, they want to, or they can cobble together 300 grand for a private money deal on about 6 or 7 single family homes, it's a nice little return. But it's only debt. He's not looking for a partner. He's not looking for there's no upside. It's just an interest rate play. So
okay. Yeah, it wouldn't be where I'm trying to go right now, but yeah. I'm sure somebody.
Yeah, there's somebody out there that would like the interest rate. They just it's not the easiest deal to get placed because everybody wants part of the upside and he just doesn't need to give that up. So
yeah,
it's a very experienced borrower with lots of capital.
True that. Well, did everybody put that connect info in here? Because I know I put my LinkedIn and I put my number. Did everybody else put that info in so we can connect up later, help each other, find a way to provide value? I know I can provide some value to in some type of way. So y'all make sure y'all hit me up. I'm open. I'm always running around, but I'm open, especially sub 2. So sub 2, hit me up. I got you on what I can do.
Love it. Anybody else want to introduce themselves? What's your super strength?
Superpower.
Yeah, I'll send out the chat, brother.
Hey, Justin, it's Mac. Justin. How you doing, brother?
Hey, what's up, brother? What are you doing, man?
Just catching the meeting a little late, brother. Sorry. Room. So I recognize some folks in there. My name is Justin McMurray. Everybody calls me Mac, obviously, because me and Justin work together a lot. So it's easy to call me by Mac. I'm active duty. I do negotiations and acquisitions for the Air Force. That's why I've kind of head toward this path with sub 2 and real estate. I have an RV rental business, have land that I have here in San Antonio that I'm working on expanding to for RV storage and things like that. I'm not perfect at it. I'm learning a lot. I think I've got the rental business down pretty well. Should be expanding here in Florida as well. So always learning, always willing to listen. Anywhere I can help anybody, even if it's just lending an ear, I'm game. And Justin can attest to that. So that's me in a nutshell, though. And I'll plug my information down the chat.
Oh, yeah. But what area in Florida are you looking at? So me and Shane and Thomas just found a unicorn agent that sent us some stuff in St. Augustine.
Okay. So the areas I'm looking at specifically for like the RV parks and stuff or even storage is over by like Herbertfield, Florida, like Pensacola Beach, Niceville area. It doesn't have to be directly there, but I've got several buddies that are down there that are retiring. So they're kind of like my logistics. They're my moving parts down there to keep the ball rolling. But I'm always open to entertain anything if the deal makes sense. You know what I mean? So
drop your buy box in the chat, brother.
Will do.
Appreciate your services, man.
Thanks, Brad.
Hey, Justin. Hello. Can you hear me?
Hello? I can hear you. What's up, brother?
Hey, what's going on? Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm just driving right now. I'm a landscaper. I'm on my way to see a property right now. But I've just been listening to the Zoom. I just appreciate everybody, you know, giving out free game. That's always valued. My name's Josue. I'm 22. I'm in sub 2. I live in Orange County, California. So anything Southern California-wise, you know, I could go to the IE, LA, OC, wherever anybody needs some help with anything. I'm definitely open to helping anybody because you never know who can help you later. I'm still in school. I just want to introduce myself to everybody, say hi. So if you see me popping up in Zooms, feel free to message me or feel free to connect with me. You know, I'm kind of brand new to this. I joined Sub 2 in November of last year, 2022. And just because I have a longtime friend of mine, he actually joined. His name is Manny Jimenez. I don't know if you know him, but he's in Sub 2. And I just helped him out with his first rental. You guys in San Jacinto, I helped him paint and get it rent ready. I think they got some tenants in this month. But yeah, just happy to meet everybody.
Good to meet you, brother.
Good to meet you. Who's hey, I got a scoop, everybody. But hey, again, good to meet y'all. Oh, let me put my picture back. Hey, again, good to meet y'all. If you need me, I'm around. You got my LinkedIn, you got my number. Hit me up. I'm always around. All right. I'm always there for sub too. So hit me up if you need me. Everybody take care.
Yep. I'm gonna log out probably, unless we're gonna do some broker calls real quick. Yes, no.
Peter. Oh, shit, I'll drop my meeting for about 20 minutes of broker calls.
Who said that?
That was me, Doc. I love fucking with brokers.
Yeah, let's do some broker calls, man. Shit.
Oh, my goodness. Is it for multifamily or single?
Multifamily.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah, I hang around for a little bit.
I see Danny Harrison smiling over here. Danny, you going to pick up the phone and dial or what?
Who's host? Oh, Venus to host. I better take that back before if she leaves, I'll shut the chat off. Let's see. How do you do this? There it goes. So who's on a computer where they can look up broker numbers? Or should I just start dropping them in the chat?
I think just drop them in the chat, be easier.
1 second. Okay.
What market is this going to be in Ohio or where is this going to be?
Wherever you pick. Where do you want the first one?
Oh, I don't care. I mean, if we just practicing, I mean, I only practice, but I mean, I'll jump in and help out. I don't care. But I love messing with brokers. I'll call them. Let's try
Cleveland.
Go in Texas. I mean, go in Texas.
Cleveland. Want to do Cleveland?
Okay. Ohio, that'll work. Where are you getting the list from? Craigslist, LoopNet. You got some whole. Okay. The old LoopNetters.
Oh, I go straight to the source, different websites that just pull the data from it. Watch, let me show you. I'll show you that after we make some calls. Here we go. That's the broker's name. This is the two numbers. Who's going first?
Nobody go, I'll go.
You got it?
I do. Yeah, it don't matter. I'm good.
I'll go first if you don't want to go.
It don't matter to me. I call brokers every day. So I love calling brokers. I don't know why.
Very commercial, the message company. I'm unable to take your call, but please leave a message.
If you didn't dial twice, you didn't call.
Yeah, I always call them three times.
Very commercial.
I'm trying to call the office. Wait. Yeah, I'm going to do the office.
Yeah, I also do mergers and acquisitions where we buy and sell properties. Thank I mean, buy and sell businesses.
I'm a Seeker company. Buy and sell Cleveland businesses?
Office, press 1. For our Medina office, press 2.
Yeah, we do that, and I'll call folks, and you know, I'm especially into the developers, real estate developers, and slightly I mess around with brokers. So if they don't answer the first time, I call them right back because they'll put you to voicemail always.
Right.
I just call right back, and they don't answer. I'll leave a voicemail on the second one, and then I'll call them again.
Very commercial. I'm a Seeker company.
Can y'all hear it?
Thank you for calling Sperry Commercial, the Masika Company's Cleveland office. If you have property you want to list or you are looking for property to all buy right. or lease,
I'm going to a different one. Vice President, okay.
Fred.
Hey, how's it going, Fred? I heard you're the go-to guy when it comes to multifamily, man.
No, wrong guy.
Really? What is your focus, man?
Industrial.
Industrial. So do you do warehouses?
Yeah.
Okay. You have anything in Cleveland, Ohio I could take a look at?
No, we really don't. You know, the market is it's been really been picked over. And anything that's coming to market, you know, is going through the full, you know, full marketing campaign. There's really nothing off market to speak of because there's been so much demand and there continues to be huge demand.
It can be on market. It don't have to be off market.
Yeah, I really don't have anything, any investment offerings. I got, no, we got buildings for lease, nothing really for sale.
Yeah, shopping center?
No shopping center.
Man. So yeah. When are you going to start picking back up on some deals, man?
You know, we're doing a lot of deals, but a lot of it's tenant rep, you know, tenant rep deals. And all our listings are predominantly for lease.
Oh, gotcha.
We don't have anything that is for sale right now.
Okay, so you can keep me in mind, like when you get something that's for sale, like a warehouse or mobile home parks or anything.
What do you guys do?
Well, we invest in, my company's called Tusk Holding Group. We invest in mobile home parks, RV parks, multifamily, 50 plus units. We do office space. It's more shopping centers and strip malls. A little bit of everything, man.
I'll write your, I got your name, I got your phone number. Anything comes up, I'll give you a call.
Hey, if you find anything with seller finance on it, you can call me, man, and I'll make sure it gets out of your hand, man.
Okay, sounds good.
All right, thank you, brother. Have a good day. Bye. All right, that's the first one.
It sounded like he was kind of talking nonsense.
Yeah, he's like, don't have no listings. What the hell?
Yeah, I'm like, so that's not, the,
that's not the type of broker I want to work with. Okay.
What are you doing? Like,
all right, you want me to drop something in there for y'all?
Oh, is everybody even into it, or nobody's really saying anything?
Take action, man.
Yeah, good,
man. Might end up getting a deal.
That's actually what I got. I'm gonna go ahead and head to my appointment unless y'all want me to do a call. But
I want you to do a call, brother.
Okay. Well, throw.
I just dropped one in there. Yeah, I just dropped one in there. And then we'll head out after this call, let you make one call.
What's the name?
You're muted, Justin.
Andrew. Andrew Chess.
Okay. 216-861-5061. Can you hear the ringing?
Don't hear it, brother.
Loud as it go.
Sorry, Andrew Chess is not available. Record your message at the tone. When you are finished, hang up or press pound for more options.
Hey, Andrew, it's Doc here. I'm calling from VTech Solutions. Hey, if you got a moment, can you give me a call? I'm interested in some properties that I seen you had for sale. If you give me a call, 361-208-0698, I'd love to hear from you, okay? You take it easy. All right, let me call them back. You still can't hear it?
No, we heard it. We heard the voicemail.
Okay.
Sorry, Andrew Chess is not available. Record your message at the tone. Sorry, Andrew
Jeff
is not available.
Okay, well, he got another number. Hang on. His mobile 4406. Oh, 666. This guy might be the devil. 4968.
Sorry, Mr. Kahn. Leave a brief message. I'll call you back as soon as I can.
He really don't want to answer the phone. Jeez.
Sorry,
Mr. Clown? Damn, I thought that was him. Okay. Moving on.
What I like about these sites, let me show you. You can get the financials, watch. Here we go. Bam. And just check out the data.
Oh, 263. Oh, they're small units, 502.
Let me zoom in real quick. Y'all see a little bit better? Actually, let me zoom out.
Also, half of them are upgraded, so they must be in the middle of a renovation.
Two-story walk-up. Construction type. Swimming pool. Damn, it's nice though.
Yeah, it's pretty. The units are small though. The average unit, 500 square feet. That's tiny.
Right. I'm gonna drop this link in the chat. Then there's this one, same kind of thing. You just go to it. You can do multifamily housing, hotels, Jacksonville. Try Jacksonville. Man, I'm gonna do Jackson, Tennessee. Nothing. Hold up. Two properties, but let's see, you can go to the advanced tab. Let's see, go to the filters. How do you do this? Gel types, see what I'm saying? You can like assumable loan or whatever.
Screen disappeared.
My screen disappeared?
No, I see it. You're back.
Oh, shit. Okay. Go back. Okay. I'm going to hit search. Apply filters. I'm going to go to the New York one. You just hit the deal room. that one. Would you like to sign up? I don't feel like signing up, but yeah, you just sign up and then it does the same thing as the other one. And then I'm gonna go to the last one, Millichap. Occupancy. What do you want the occupancy to be? Like at least
BSC. Oh, hold up. What do you mean occupancy? How many put it at 95. Put it at 95. But yeah.
Okay.
Mine a little bit everywhere wrong. Right now.
What the hell? Okay, I'm just gonna pick one. I'm just showing y'all this little how to get the data right away, and then we'll click out of this, and we're gonna start making calls again, right? I think it's easy, right? You just get the data from the site.
Yeah, and get the brokers too.
Right. Yeah, get the brokers too, of course. But then you could just underwrite the deal right away. Yeah. Be like, this didn't work. But yeah, I'm gonna get straight to the calls. Here we go. Houston. Multifamily specialist. You want to call him, brother?
Yeah, that name sounds familiar.
It does.
Like I feel like I might have called him.
It does sound familiar. Yeah,
I'll call him. Yeah, that's his number here. Let me call him. Oh, you moved it. Okay, there it is. One. All right. 7, 3, 5, 8, 6, 15, 7.
Thank you for calling Box of Property. Swella, how can I help you?
Hi, I'm sorry, I didn't get your name. You said Swella?
My name is Swella. How can I help
okay,
you?
Okay, good morning. I'm looking for Brian. My name is Doc.
Brian who?
Hines, is he available?
Brian who?
Hines.
I'm sorry, who are you?
I'm sorry, maybe my connection's bad. It's Hines, H-I-N-E-S.
Brian Hines, okay. Have you been speaking to him previously?
I have not spoken to him yet. There's a chance that I may have spoken to him in the past, but I'm looking to speak to him about some multifamily properties that he has.
Are you a real estate agent?
No, ma'am. I'm an investor.
Okay. Oh, you're an investor.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you want me to just go ahead and take your information? I don't know that he's available.
If he's ready to make some money, he should take my call. I would love to. I feel like I might have spoken to Brian in the past, but I'm not 100% certain. I know. I do deals out of Houston, Texas quite often. And, but I don't, maybe he doesn't, I feel like he's familiar, but he may not be. But no. I have his number.
I think he's just on y'all's radar. He's on a bunch of the emails and stuff.
And I'm sorry. What do you mean?
What are you looking to do?
Well, tell me this. Let me make sure we're on the same page. What do you mean y'all? Because I'm an investor. I have several brokerages. I'm not sure what you mean when you say y'all.
Right. Can I get your name?
My name is Doc.
D-O-C.
Yeah, that's what I go by. Okay. Everybody call me Doc. What's that?
What's your last name?
Easley. E-A-S-L-E-Y.
And then, what do you like specifically, like if you're looking as far as investing, what are you proposing?
This is new to me. I'm sorry. This is new to me. I don't typically go through all this. I mean, I'm looking to talk to Brian. If he's available, I'd love to speak to him, make some money, do some deals, but I don't need to give all this information to you. Either he's ready to chat or he's not. I'll just move on.
Okay. Well, I can take information for him and get him to reach back out to you, but no, he's not available.
Okay. Well, let me give you my number. It's
361-208-0898.
Okay. Do you have a good email address for yourself, sir? He could reach me. I'm going to give you two emails. One is doc@docbuyshouses.org. And the next email, I have two.
A commercial real estate brokerage, correct?
Well, I'm a commercial real estate broker myself. Okay. So if you would, let me give you my other email. Okay. Let me give you my other email because it's typically two emails. It's Vernon, vernon.easley@exitrealityseaside.com.
Okay, just repeat that other part after the
app. Is exitrealityseaside.com. And I'm actually, I got several, what's that?
Did you want me to include any information regarding your call?
Well, I have, I got several appointments left for the rest of the day. I'm open for the next hour. If you want to call me. If not, I'll have my secretary reach back out next week and see and make a follow-up call. Otherwise, if I don't hear from Brian or he don't reach back, I'm just going to assume he's not interested. Okay?
Okay. Is there any other information?
There is no other information. No, ma'am.
Okay.
All right. You take care. I don't like her.
I don't like her either, man.
I get those from time to time where the secretary want to question you to death. Like, does he want to do business or not? I'm not everybody else that's calling. You know, I'm me.
Right.
Anyway, moving on.
That reminds me that they're as bad as the ones on Realtor when you call for the listing agent and they're like, hey, what listing? And they try to represent you, like bypass you, you know what I mean? Before you reach the listing agent. Have you ever had that shit? Stupid.
Yeah, I don't allow that in my brokerage. That's not allowed at all.
Who wants to make a call, y'all? Who's up?
All right, yeah. I say somebody else jump in and get some experience. Oh, I see some fire. What's the fire for? Is that for me making smart comments at a young lady pissing me off? Yeah. I want him to call back because you know, he's just a broker, you know? I mean, I'm going to light his ass up about his secretary if he calls back. He will because he can be interested. Yeah. I'm going to have him sucking on my big toe. Like, come on. I'm sorry. Like, okay. Who we got here? All right, y'all. I'm running dry. I'm definitely over. I want to see somebody else call them, and then I'm out.
All right, let me share my screen, y'all. All
right. And I do an appointment at 2. Yes.
Is it sharing?
Can you confirm?
Not yet. Oh, no, I don't see it.
Okay. Katie Smith. I like her, but she old. She might be old and hungry, though.
And Justin, if you're talking, it's muted.
Oh, shit. Okay. So that's weird. It makes me unshare my screen to unmute. That was strange. I'm going to drop the numbers in the chat. Seems like he's the land plug. You gonna try it out, Danny?
I might have to.
Yeah, you gotta do it, man.
No, okay. Usually, I've just been doing residential, so it's my first time kind of messing around with commercial here.
I just got a land buyer too, so this be interesting, and they're in Tampa.
Okay.
Don't copy my smart talking. Leave that part out of it.
William.
Call has been forwarded to an automatic.
Okay, William doesn't want to answer. Sanford.
Can I help you?
Hey, this is Sanford.
It is.
Hey, what's going on, Sanford? I heard you're the go-to guy for commercial real estate in the Tampa area.
Oh, that's flattering. Where are you from, sir?
I'm based out of Georgia, but me and my partners are doing some investing in the Tampa area too. I just giving you a call just to kind of see if you have anything. We're specializing in like multifamily shopping centers and some stuff like that.
Sure. You know, it's a tough market. Why don't you email me a list of your parameters and I'll circulate it amongst my team members and see if we have anything that's a fit.
Okay. Okay. Nothing that comes to mind right now.
No, sir. My email is I don't know what your parameters are. Okay. My email is mar, M-A-H-R.
Okay.
And marcompany.com.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much, Sanford.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Bye. That was decent. Well,
when I do buyer outreach, I'm going to say that now. Instead of buy box, I'm going to be like, what's your parameters?
Yeah, just use your own buy box and then just add whatever state you call in and just add it to it. That's what I do.
That William dude's calling me back.
Hell yeah.
Hello, this is Dave.
Bill, that's about returning your calls.
Hey, what's going on, Bill? I was calling you because I heard you're the go-to land guy in the Tampa area.
Well, careful of your sources, you know.
What's going on, man? Do you possibly have anything going on right now?
Yeah. What kind of land piques your interest?
Got anything. I got a few partners looking for some stuff on the coast, and then a few guys looking for just kind of bigger ones, maybe 5 to 10 acres.
Okay, for development, single family or multi-family?
Both. Even up to 100 acres too.
Okay. Yeah, I've got 7 agents with me. We've got a couple hundred listings.
Okay.
So we do in that daily work. We have some multifamily land. I think we still got some single family. It's actually come alive again. So it's kind of interesting. Yes.
Okay.
But yeah, we got apartment land. 4 or 5 pieces there, I guess. Price from $25,000 to $75,000 a door.
Okay. Yeah, definitely interested in the multifamily for sure.
Okay.
I can go ahead. If I can get your email, I'll send your email, or vice versa. So I can.
Yeah, it's Bill at DPG Dirt DOG.com. Bill at DDirt.com.
Okay, Bill at what was the at what? Sorry, you
at V
T H E
Dirt DIRT Dog DRT.
The dirtdog.com.
.com.
Okay, I gotcha. I'll be reaching out here shortly. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, man.
Yep, I'll be back by computer in an hour or so. Send you off some stuff.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Bye.
How do you feel, bro?
All right. Just, you know, about taking the action, man. Taking the action and learning.
Yes, sir. Just do it. Hey, man, just do it. That was good.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm real comfortable when it comes to like talking about houses. I've never done anything with land or even the commercial, but I will be, of course. So I just kind of wing the crap out of it. You know, that's all it takes is, just if you don't know what you're doing, just, you know, just take the action and you'll learn along the way.
Exactly.
And stay confident, man. You was pretty confident. Just stay confident. I try to control the conversation. I guess I'm bad at that, but I try to control the conversation because a lot of times, you know, I need to get to who I need to talk to and get past all the nonsense. And then not having people ask me dumb questions. It's like, you know, because I got a whole list. I might have a list of 50 people. You know, I don't have time to be answering your dumb questions. You know, are you trying to, you know, figure out who I am? Just answer the question and let's move on, you know, right? Right, Justin? You want to make money? Let's make money.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Don't be fucking around. You know, I don't care who called you before. I'm calling you. You know,
that girl was nosy. That girl was nosy in your business,
right?
Yeah, she was nosy. That's why I was like, yo, I'm not used to this. Like, where is he? I bet he's gonna return my call. I'm gonna let y'all know. Hey, I got to go. But hey, y'all, it was beautiful. I'm out.
I'm out too, y'all. Hey, it's been a pleasure. Tune in next Thursday, same time.